So in last class we completed arc welding, that is metal arc welding. There are two types of arc weldings, metal arc welding and carbon arc welding. So here the difference is, in metal arc welding the welding electrode, I mean the filling agent, are in between the joint. So the material which is to be melted is of same material. Suppose you wanted to join two iron pieces, then we have to use electrode with iron, and that iron has to melt and it has to go into the joint and form a bond. So if you want to weld some branch, so you have to use as of same material branch has to melt and go to the joint and form a perfect bonding. So like that, in metallic arc welding we use the electrode of same material, and in this we can use DC and AC. But in case of carbon arc welding, so we use carbon electrodes. Usually its size is about 12 mm diameter and some 15 to 20 centimeters, and it will carry about 800 amperes through that electrode. So such a high current flowing through that electrode, when it is connected to that joint, because of this heavy current, that electrode gets melted, and that electrode melted, after melting it will hold the two metal pieces together and it forms a perfect joint. So again, in this there is a small caution or important thing we need to keep in mind, that the electrode always must be provided with negative polarity, and the job or workpiece to be always connected with the positive polarity. So why it is like so, means if you reverses that positivity connected to electrode and negative connected to the workpiece, then what happened, because of this carbon forming at the electrode, okay, at the negative polarity only carbon forming, a whitish color carbon formation is takes place. So if it is connected in opposite way, that is electrode positive and workpiece at negative, so carbon forms at the workpiece, then while welding the carbon forming and welding both together, which make the welding is not so strong, mechanically strong, that may become brittle. So that's why that electrode is always connected to negative and the jaw workpieces are connected to positive. So in order to maintain this electrode is always negative, so AC is, it is an alternating polarity, so AC is not preferred. In carbon arc welding DC is preferred, and that too negative polarity is connected to the electrode and positive polarity connected to the workpiece. Again, in this arc welding there are two methods, that is flux, with flux and without flux. With flux means we use the flux during the welding process so that the joint, welded joint, should not get oxidized. If we don't use flux, the welding joint gets oxidized with the atmosphere, and over a period of time it becomes less strength, its strength decreases. So no flux means there is no flux, so oxidization takes place. And if we use to prevent the oxidization, we use flux. Okay, so for non-ferrous materials we don't use flux because there is no oxidization. Usually ferrous materials gets oxidized very easily, we use flux to the ferrous materials only. So where we use this carbon arc welding, normally used for copper and its alloys, okay, it is also well suited for rapid work or cases where as in repair of castings, large quantity of filler materials to be deposited. It is useful for welding thin high nickel alloys and low carbon iron electrodes, can be employed for welding iron and steel. usual our outside weldings, okay, welding some mesh, welding some grill, okay, welding some window grills. So these are all electrode weldings only. That is carbon arc electrode welding. In that they use low carbon iron electrode so that its carbonized effect can be reduced and the joint becomes a little bit greater. I mean, perfect joint takes place. Again, we don't use flux in our day-to-day joints. So we discussed about this welding. So what are the conditions for a successful welding? So which welding process can we say it is a good welding just has happened? Okay. So for a successful welding, so we have to have some specified conditions to follow, then only a perfect welding can take place. First of all, the voltage should be such that in order to, in case of DC supply, the voltage should be 50 to 60 volts, and in case of AC supply, that is 70 to 100 volts. The arc voltage depends upon the type of metal and the flux of electrode. Suppose the material carbon welding and iron welding, bronze welding, for different materials, the electrode voltage also changes. It varies from 20 to 35 volts plus or minus like that. A long arc requires a higher voltage than a short arc. Okay. So if you keep your electrode away from the job or workpiece, if it is a distance is more, it requires more voltage to maintain the arc. So in order to have proper arc, so we must have a sufficient length to maintain the arc, not so far or not too near to the job workpiece. Current ranges would be about 30 to 500 amps for normal manual welding processes. In case of automated, the currents may go very higher. That is about more than 600 amperes like that. Aluminium and certain alloys can only be welded with DC. Okay, some alloys can only be welded with DC supply, not AC. In order to get sound weld, the absolute fusion of parent metal and electrode metal has to happen properly. That means the electrode material has to be melted and the job metal has also to be melted. These two materials has to combine, okay, with each other, then only the perfect joint joining will takes place. For good weld, it is very important to select a suitable electrode with correct size, means suitable diameter, suitable material like less carbon material or ferrous material electrode, or different type of material as well as size of the electrode. Surfaces to be welded must be clean and dust free. Okay, then only the welding takes place. Good welding takes place. Correct welding technique should be used. Okay. Sufficient current welding lacks proper penetration and excess current welding cuts the parent metal. So the correct current should be selected. If the current flowing through the electrode is more, then that may damage the job, work job. If the current flowing through the electrode is very less, then that electrode may not melt. So we have to take care of proper current, sufficient amount of current is to be flown through the electrode. These are some conditions to be satisfied for a successful welding. Then what are the sources for this welding? We know that the welding requires a voltage about 50 to 70 volts for DC, some 75 to 100 volts for AC, and while during the welding, when the welding starts, the voltage may fall, current may increase. So this is a difficult type of voltage source or supply source we required. Okay. For that, we use welding generators, separately designed welding generators, as well as welding transformers. They are also separately designed. Here in this, we can see welding generator. This is DC generator. There is a shunt field and there is a series field. So the series field is connected in series with the supply. Okay. So current flows through the workpiece. I already told you positivity given to the workpiece, negative polarity given to the electrode. So this negative polarity connected through the series winding to the generator. So this generator has two windings, shunt field winding and series field winding. So they are designed such that the flux produced through the series field winding will oppose the flux produced by the shunt field winding. That means it is in opposite to each other. Flux produced by two windings is opposite to each other. The resultant net flux decreases. It is nothing but a differential compound DC generator. In a differential compound DC generator, when the load increases, the net flux decreases and voltage decreases. That's what we require. So for a generator, welding generator, at the time of starting of the welding, we must require sufficient voltage. When the welding starts, current flows through the job and electrode. So that current flows through the series field winding, then net flux decreases. So like that, welding generators are designed. Okay. So you can see this falling of voltage. Okay. So this is the voltage. Initially, before welding, current is zero, voltage is 50 to 70 volts. When the arc is started, current starts flowing. So as the current increases, the voltage decreases. This is a general operating point of a DC generator. Okay. So this OB is called arc voltage. During the welding process, we should not allow the current to increase more than this. Okay, we will maintain the gap between the electrode. Say this is electrode and this is the job workpiece, and this is the arc stuck between this. Okay. So if you increase the distance between the electrode and job, then the arc length increases, resistance increases, current decreases. Similarly, if you move your electrode towards the job, less the distance between the electrode and the job, so the arc is getting increased, more current flows like this. So we'll maintain this current by holding the electrode at proper position. So we will maintain the arc current and arc voltage in a safe limits like this. So that's why voltage will not fall and current will not increase. And this is the short circuit current, worst possible current through the welding generator. So generator is designed in such a way that it can produce huge amount of current by reducing the voltage. It's reducing its voltage. Okay. Like this. Similarly, welding transformer. In case of AC, so there is no separate AC welding generator. The available AC supply is used to welding. We used to see whenever there is a welding is required, some electrician will guy will bring one small box in that it consists of a transformer. So he will connect the wires to that and electrode and a work job. Okay. So in that small transformer, it consists of these type of windings. One is primary and secondary winding. Where secondary winding, there are tappings, so we can select the appropriate voltage based upon the job and the material to be welded. So we can select the appropriate voltage. Here it is connected to say 80 volts setting. So it is connected to some 80 volt setting. So it is connected with a reactance coil. So this is a reactance coil. Here also it is provided with tapping. So what happens here, actually similar to DC generator, we should get this drooping characteristics. So when current increases, voltage has to fall. fault rate has to fall. This is called a drooping characteristic. So here we connected one reactance coil. When current increases, the voltage drop in the reactance coil increases. So the available voltage minus voltage in the inductor equal to the net voltage available at the electrode. Okay. So if the current increases, voltage drop, voltage consumed by this inductor coil increases, then electrode voltage decreases. When the electrode is moved away, no current flows through this job or workplace, workpiece, then this is zero, then this voltage appears across the electrode V like that. So here this is the reactance coil. Again, there are some other methods to adjust this welding transformer current. So one of the method is tapping reactor method, moving coil method, and saturable reactor method. So tapping reactor method means the same thing. Reactor is connected with some tapping. So if you want to control the voltage of this electrode during the welding process, you have to change this tapping. So if you put this at this last point, means more voltage drop takes place. If you keep it in the middle, lesser voltage drop. If you keep it at the beginning, no voltage drop at all. So like that you can control the transformer voltage at the tap reactor method. Next, moving coil method. So this is another arrangement. It is costly. Why? Because this coil has to be moving. So there is a core. This is a core, three-limbed core. Okay. So flux flows like this through the central limb. This is a primary winding. So primary winding supply is given. So it produces flux and flux flows through like this. And there is a secondary winding. So this secondary winding is connected to the welding process, that is electrode and the job. So with the help of this handle, we can move this secondary coil towards the primary coil or away from the primary coil within the same limb. As the distance increases, the flux linkage decreases. As the distance decreases, flux linkage increases, voltage will increase like that. So that the voltage across the electrode and the job can be controlled with the moving coil method. And the last method is saturable reactor method. In this method, the AC supply given to primary and secondary. This is secondary circuit through the welding. So in here, in between, a reactor is connected. Again, reactor is similar to a transformer of two windings. So one winding of reactor connected in series with the workpiece and the electrode. So for this, they will send a DC current through the other winding of a reactor. So what happens here? By sending the DC current, again it acts like a DC machine pole, like North Pole and South Pole. It also produces flux, but in a constant flux. So current flowing through this winding of a reactor is AC. Current flowing through this winding is DC. Okay, constant flux. So when you increase this DC current such that the core in the transformer gets saturated. So once the core is saturated, the flux cannot increase more than that flux. So the voltage across the electrode is limited. Okay. So suppose there is a, this is a core, this is a flux. So this is a flux, saturation flux. So this saturation flux, because of flux through electrode, and that is AC, current flowing through the electrode, and flux, that is DC. Okay. Suppose if you increase DC current, so for lesser AC current only, saturation takes place. Suppose if you decrease DC current, so for higher AC currents only, saturation takes place. Like that, you can control the voltage across the electrode. This is a suitable reactor, I mean saturable reactor method. Then final topic is sequence welding circuit. Sequence means one after one. Sequence. First this process completed, then with some time gap, next process has to start. Again after that gap, another process has to start, like that. Sequence means one after one. After completing this, which one next? After completing that, which one next? Like that, that is sequence. So in a automated welding processes, it is all sequenced, I mean controlled with automation, electronic circuits. So it follows some set of processes. So with particular timing intervals, then with that they will achieve the good joints, welding joints. So here in this sequence of welding, it is automated welding processes, welding sequence, that is timing is involved. So they use some timer circuit. So this welding cycle may divide into four successive segments, that is freezing time, weld time, hold time and off time. Squeeze time means bring the two metal pieces together. Okay. Squeeze, apply some pressure and bring these metals to be brought, bring the two metals to be jointed or jobs to be jointed together. Weld time, now start welding. Okay. Hold time, so just after completion of welding, don't lose the pressure, you please hold the same. Then off time means remove the pressure, remove the job, so that the job can be removed, like that. So for all the processes, it involves with time. Squeeze time means first hold the electrodes together for a certain period of time. Then after that time, start weld. And welding has to happen for some duration. Then stop welding. After completion of welding, hold time. Just hold the same together for some time. Then off time means remove that electrode, remove that job, remove the workpiece, like that. So squeeze time, during the squeeze time, electrodes are brought close to the work and sufficient pressure is developed. Okay. Then weld time, during this time the current flows through the primary and transformer and heat is generated. It is welding. Holding, during this electrodes are held together after interruption of weld current and weld solidarities. I mean after welding is completed, but still it is holding some time to cool or to become that joint permanent, like that. Then during off time, electrodes are opened, old work is removed and new work is kept ready, welding sequence of next process will start, like this. So this is squeeze timer, weld timer, hold timer and off timer. So all the timers are connected. And output of one timer is given as an input to the next timer. Output given to the input to the next timer. Output given to the input to the next timer. So when the switch is closed, this timer 1 starts. Okay. After some time delay, after say 5 seconds. So when the timer started, the holding process, it will hold the two jobs, two work pieces for a 5 seconds. Say, timer 1 5 seconds, timer 2 5 seconds, timer 3 5 seconds, okay, half some 15 seconds, okay, say something like this. So when the switch is closed, it will hold the two jobs for 5 seconds. After this, it will initiate the timer 2. After completion of this squeeze time, then only timer 2 gets started. So it will weld the two jobs for 5 seconds. During 5 seconds, this won't start. After completion of T2, then only it will send the signal to the next timer. Then it will hold for 5 seconds. After completion of 5 seconds only, it will start the next timer, that is half timer. Then we can remove the jobs and we can remove that other any dust particles are, we can clean that and we can replace with the new job, and again it will initiate the next welding sequence like that. So this is a block diagram of sequence welding cell. For greater accuracy, we use a 555 timer. So this is a popular IC for generating time delays. Okay, this is 555 IC timer. So I think with this this chapter is completed. Fifth chapter, electrical heating and welding. Okay, fifth chapter is electrical heating and welding. So in the next class we will start sixth chapter, that is next chapter, electric traction. So if you have any doubts, just bring to me.